Hello, 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 and welcome to Oprah and Sis's channel. And today I am finally reviewing the second episode of season 2 of A Series of Unfortunate Events. Almost said Oprah and Sis's there. Well, basically this show is continuing and so am I with my reviews of it. The episode starts out where the previous one left off, with Couch Genghis, aka Count Olaf, walking onto the stage with his hilarious disguise of the turban and this very modern coach-style outfit. I love Neil Patrick Harris as an actor, especially as Count Olaf and his disguises, though I don't agree with his personal life. I absolutely love him as an actor, and I really do enjoy his performance in this movie, I mean in this show. Every disguise is very hilarious. He brings so much good to the table with all the roles, aka Count Olaf's roles, and Couch Genghis is no exception. Here, he really shows this disgusting, despising character that is also somehow really sort of hilarious. And the writers too, they wrote some great dialogue and lines for him. And basically it starts off with this little moment, which I absolutely love every time I watch it. It's so hilarious. The Baudelaires decide to confront Count Olaf to reveal his evil plan, sort of, and to end the circus show on the school stage. And this is where the episode gets really funny. When basically Count Olaf is the kids are like, take off your turban and reveal your one eyebrow, and he's like, absolutely not. I wear this turban for religious reasons. And then they're like, and what religion might that be? And he's like, that's so hilarious. I think that was in the book. I don't remember. I'll need to reread it. I think that's from the book. It's greatly portrayed here. It's extremely funny. It's very good written humor. We're very professional. And I also have to mention quickly that Lemony Snicket's, like the narrator, stepping onto the stage, sort of, step and telling the audience about something, like what school spirit means, stuff like that. At the beginning of the first season, and even closer to the end, it was fine, but here it already starts getting on my nerve. I am so, like, bored when he says that, and it's almost like a distraction from the moment. But, so after that, Larry, who is still somehow walking in the freezer, is basically rescued by Jack Snicket, who is Lemony Snicket's brother, in this very James Bond style. Like, Snicket? Jack Snicket. Like, you get it? Bond? Jane, I'm Bond. James Bond. And after that, basically, they are, Count Olaf is taking this whistle and starting to whistle, as now he is making this program for the Baudelaires, for them to run during the night around and around these circles, like for very long. And they don't understand how is he's planning to get their fortune now, but it definitely involves part of the plan to run for them around, 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 like all night. And we later learn that it's actually for them to get so tired that they cannot sort of complete the exams, and therefore they will be sort of expelled, and then Count Olaf can get their fortune by getting them. And it's a very complicated, convoluted plan, but I like it because it's a very cool idea from Daniel Handler, the author. And after that, we of course have this terrible sexual joke. Like, it's so disgusting. It's not even funny for me. It's gross. Come on, like, listen.
Isn't it time for your little light to shine? Oh, I need a few minutes to rosin my bow. Don't say that in front of the children.
Anyway, what I have to praise here is the interaction between Vice Principal Nero and Count Olaf, aka Couch Genghis. First of all, it's written very funnily and very well once again. And secondly, both actors perform it phenomenally. Like, their interactions with each other, how they act on each other's lines, is great. I absolutely love it. After that, we have montages of basically the children running around the laps. And I think the show really succeeds in showing how tired they are. While making it comedic, you also really feel tired as well, because the show really shows you how it shows you. But I really liked the funny element of Mrs. Bass being the robber of Molturley Money Management Bank. But and basically how tired they are, it really is shown with just how Carmelita annoys them, how the camera goes around them and stuff like that. And after that, basically they realize Count Olaf's plan. And so what they do is basically they decide to study, the real Baudelaires decide to study, while the Quagmires dress into the Baudelaires and use a bag of flour like a doll to be Sunny. Basically, they start running instead of the Baudelaires because it's very dark and Olaf doesn't see anything. And the real Baudelaires are studying while the Quagmires are running along with the doll with the bag of flour inside it, who is attached to Quagmire's hands with a rope. However, despite that, the rope eventually rips apart and the baby sort of stops running, and that's where the real thing happens. Count Olaf catches attention of that, and basically, while the Baudelaires are studying there in their shack, he starts chasing the Quagmires, who hide in the library, they hide there, while the book, which is the the incomplete history of secret organizations, which Larry should have delivered to the Baudelaires, because he lost the book, they found it in that library, and while they hid in this place, they sort of started reading the book, and that's where they discover lots of exposition. And I don't I don't hate expositions. In fact, I think it's a very good thing to move the plot forward. I'm not one of those people who doesn't like it. And basically, it tells about the spyglass, which they connect all together, like, because they got the Baudelaire's piece. And it talks about the sugar ball, which will later come into play in the later episodes and the books. And they also talk about, how do you say it, lots of things. Like, they discover most of the secrets. However, then we hear them scream, and it cuts away to the Baudelaires waking up the next day, which is, I think, a really cool way to sort of end this little part. And after that, Mr. Poe arrives with a bag of candy for Vice Principal Nero, which he should deliver for the Baudelaires not being good on their lessons. And that is a comedic, really comedic part, which was also really in the book, but here it's much more focused on, and I think it's really fun. Then, basically, Mr. Poe how do you say it? The exam start. This is the most hilarious part. Just the questions that the teachers are asking are so ridiculous. You almost like you just want to laugh because it's so stupid, and that's what it's supposed to be. But the Baudelaires succeed, and Vice Principal Nero says, like, you can stay. However, Couch Genghis goes into a fist fight with them, saying that if they lose, they should be expelled anyway. And this is the part that wasn't in the book, as far as I remember. And I think it really wasn't a good climax in the show. It really was very boring, dull, and... oh my god, it just felt so unnecessary and so uninteresting and just boring, cliched. And basically, Sunny succeeded in throwing the boots away. And after that, Vice Principal is like, oh, I understand what you children were talking about all along. And he's like, you should always work and work and always go on and stuff like that. However, the Baudelaires point out that the real thing they were saying is that Olaf has a tattoo on his ankle of the eye. And that's how he's revealed again. And after that, he sort of attempts to escape and he starts running. And then we have this moment where the Baudelaires are sort of unwrapping his turban, which was kind of very not satisfying. It kind of looked a bit, I don't know why, it's kind of a bit freaked me out. And after that, we see Olaf with this very, very funny and ridiculous amount like of hair. I mean, it's normal amount, but it's just so in such a form that it makes it really like so like, oh my god, just how he looks. That looked so cringy. And after that, it turns out that the crew of Olaf has captured basically the quagmires, and they start chatting VFD, 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 which is, of course, as we later learn, the secret organization that their parents were a part of. And basically they shout VFD, VFD, and they manage to throw one of piece of the spyglass. But overall they are kidnapped, and that's where the episode ends. So this one was definitely a good one. It's a very good adaptation of the books, and I think it captures the tone perfectly. It doesn't add too much pointless VFD stuff, so it doesn't really mix that thing. But it also really well sets up the next episodes and shows the personality of all the characters, especially the supporting cast. And now it's time for the... first of all, the rating. I'd give this one a 9 out of 10. 9 out of 10. And also, now I just want to do an end segment where I basically give an idea for a scene that could be used that would improve the show, in my opinion. So, for those who missed my previous episode, in the original book, the staff at the cafeteria who put the food were actually the two white-faced women, old women in here, and they were just in silver masks, basically covering their faces so no one could see them. And at the end, they were the one who kidnapped the quagmires, like, took them, and... if this was included in the show, I would give a very cool explanation as to why the supercomputer didn't detect Olaf through its scanning. Basically, my idea is that the white-faced women who worked at there like already longer than Olaf before came there, and basically... because they had the access to the computer, because they were a member of staff, they changed it completely so that the computer would not, be able to verify Olaf, even if he didn't have a disguise. And I think it's an absolute brilliant idea. I think that would be very great and it would explain a lot. Thank you very much, and goodbye!